Welcome back, fellow biologists. It's Justin again. Now that I've learned that anyone can be a scientist by thinking like one, I cannot stop making observations and asking questions like, how much does a whale shark, the largest fish in the sea, eat in one day? Or do members of the same species act differently in different parts of the world? How do scientists test new medications to make sure that they're safe and effective? I have so many questions. And luckily for biologists like you and me, science can point us towards the answers. However, not all questions are investigated in the exact same way. So in this lesson, we're going to be exploring this concept as we describe the three different types of scientific investigations, explain what they're used for, and differentiate between independent and dependent variables. Let's get into it. In our last lesson, we learned all about the steps of the scientific method. Today, we'll be focusing on different types of investigations that can occur as part of this process. Once we've made an observation, asked a question, and formed a hypothesis, how do we know what kind of investigation to use to answer our question? Well, that will all depend on the type of question we're trying to answer. Let's say I want to know what kinds of birds visit my backyard during a certain time. For that, I can use a descriptive investigation, which focuses on simply observing and recording findings. Scientists perform this type of investigation to answer all kinds of questions, like what kinds of foods do different animals eat? Or where do they travel during the day? What are some life science questions that you think can be answered using descriptive investigations? Pause the video here and write down your thoughts in your guided notes. So, did you come up with some good questions? At this point, you might be thinking, descriptive investigations are easy. Anyone can make observations. However, as with anything, the more knowledgeable you are about what you're studying, the more useful your observations will likely be. Remember my question about how much a whale shark eats in a day? This question can also be answered using a descriptive investigation, but to answer it, I'd have to be knowledgeable about where whale sharks hang out, how to best observe them, and how to measure the amount of food they eat. In other words, I'd have to be an expert on whale sharks and the ocean they live in. Luckily for me, experts have already answered this question, so I could just go on the internet and read all about it. I can find out about a whale shark's diet, the top speed of a cheetah, or even the number of times a hummingbird flaps its wings in a second. It's important to keep in mind, though, that reading about things is considered research and not a descriptive investigation. This crazy amount of information is available because countless scientists have put in hard work performing descriptive investigations in the past. And every new investigation gives us more and more information, providing us with a strong foundation for further research and experimentation. So, what if I have a question about how two or more things are similar or different? For that, I would use a comparative investigation, which focuses on collecting data for comparison. Some questions comparative investigations can answer are, how is the DNA of dogs similar or different from that of wolves? Or, how does the appearance of female cardinals compare to that of male cardinals? What are some examples of questions you think can be answered with comparative investigations? Write down your thoughts in your guided notes. Did you come up with some good ones? Comparative investigations are great for examining broad connections between living things. But what if I want to test how one thing specifically affects another, like how sunlight affects plant height, or how medicine affects recovery time from an illness? To accomplish this, I'll need to perform an experiment, which you've probably heard of. Experiments involve clearly defined independent and dependent variables. An independent variable is the variable that the scientist manipulates or changes in order to study its effect. The dependent variable, in turn, is the variable that is measured or observed in response to the independent variables. For example, let's say we want to test how two types of medicine affect the time it takes for someone to recover from an illness. In this case, the type of medicine given is manipulated by the researcher, so it's the independent variable. The recovery time is measured as a result, making it the dependent variable. Let's try another example. If we were testing how sunlight affects plant height, what would our independent and dependent variables be? Pause the video and write down what you think in your guided notes. We can easily manipulate or change the amount of sunlight, making it our independent variable. We observe and measure plant height, making that our dependent variable. If I'm measuring the effect of something like sunlight on plant growth or medicine on recovery time, I also need to have a control group, or a group that doesn't receive the treatment. This group acts as a baseline for comparison. In our medicine experiment, a researcher would not just give half the patients medicine A and the other half medicine B. Instead, the researcher has to also assign a group of patients that doesn't receive any medicine at all. Now, before you yell at me about how that's not fair, think about it this way. Let's say that both group A and group B recover in 3 days. That suggests that both medicines affect the recovery time in similar ways, but did they actually get better faster? Or would they have gotten better in 3 days without the medicine too? To figure out if either medicine actually made a difference, we would need to compare our results to a control group that didn't take medicine. If the control group takes longer to recover, that suggests that the medicines reduce recovery time. Now we're ready to talk about constants, which are factors that are kept the same throughout the entire investigation. This ensures that only the independent variable is affecting our results. So in our medicine experiment, some examples of things we want to keep constant are the general age and health of the subjects. If one group was significantly younger and healthier than another, it would be hard to say if any differences in recovery time were caused by the medicine or by these other factors. As you can see, creating a fair test about how one thing affects another is tricky, which is why experiments have more rules than descriptive and comparative investigations. Luckily for us, we don't need to perform an experiment to answer every single scientific question we might have. We can use descriptive investigations to find out more information through observation, and we can use comparative investigations to collect and compare data on different living things or conditions. We only need to use experiments if we're testing how one variable specifically affects another, without interference from other factors. In our next lesson, we'll be examining how scientists effectively measure the results of their investigations. Until then, fellow biologists, I'm Justin, and remember, life is full of wonders. So keep learning and don't ever stop wondering. Hey.